court will now come to order. Remain seated.
Well, when you employed me, One of my first jobs was to look and find out what had happened in the estates, what was going on, and to try to do two things. One was to go ahead and respond to the demand that you make some decisions on these creditor claims now that there was money in the estate, and to kind of propose a way to see if we couldn't get going on the case.
Now, on page four of the exhibit, I see a number of itemized numbers down here. It appears the granting and denying expenses. If you could go through those and explain to the court the process. Let me begin by saying, did you work with me on this?
Yes.
Okay. You can go through these and explain the process that we went through.
Well, this first one was regarding the responding to the claims from Maria Kingery. And it's her creditor claim for $16,626.06. And the first thing we said was there's about $1,400 worth of this claim for reimbursement that you were denying. You were denying because it was based on payments from an account to which rent had been collected and deposited for the estate.
When you say rent was collected and deposited for the estate, does that mean rent that was specified to lawyers being paid by Mr. Quesada?
Yes, it was. And these were things that happened. This was collections before you were involved as administrator of the estate. The second thing was there were three or four things that said there's about $2,600 worth of expenses that we're conditionally denying, but if you can show us the documents that say that it's really tied to the estate in an appropriate way, then you reconsider. The last thing was $12,569.69. It said we're conditionally approving these, but we would like to see the supporting documentation for it. And then over on the next page, it concluded, said, you know, please give us the supporting documentation within 10 days, and, you know, that's where you were going with it.
With regards to Maria's claims, did she give you any supporting documentation? Her attorney give you any supporting documentation within 10 days?
No, I don't think we got the supporting documentation that was requested until Mr. Beggs was retained shortly before we had a declaratory judgment here.
Now, going down on page five, Freddie's creditor. If you could explain to the court those entries there.
Freddie Alvarez, by the way, Maria Kingery's client was on the Graciela Alvarez estate. Freddie Alvarez's claim was on his father's estate, Federico Alvarez's estate, and basically, you approved conditionally $13,734.98 of a $13,898.98 claim, and then you conditionally disapproved a payment to the Fulton County Probate Court, which was basically the same kind of thing you disapproved of for Maria Kingery. And we've asked for supporting documentation to support the claims that he made.
Did he supply, or his attorney supply, any supporting documentation at any point?
Yes. And I point out, at the bottom of page five, there's a footnote regarding addressing the joint account claim. Mrs. Kingery had said, and I understood, had said that there was a joint account that Freddie had with his father. I'm sorry, Freddie Alvarez had with his father. And she said that account was for convenience and should be considered in part of the estate. And we said there that based on the information that was available to you, there was not sufficient evidence in your judgment to overcome the presumption that in the banking code that if two names are on an account, it's presumed to be a joint account with survivorship unless there is clear and convincing evidence of contrary intent at the time the account's opened. And we had not seen anything to show to overcome that clear and convincing evidence requirement.
To your recollection, did we ever receive anything from Maria or her attorneys?
I mean, we did hear that everybody knows, it's common knowledge that this was for convenience, but I never saw anything that met what I would consider to be an evidentiary standard to overcome that.
Now, you also made some reference in your letter on page 6 to the Lanier Place property, and I think you looked at the last paragraph of that, you were talking in practicality about how the proceeds of that would ultimately go down to the heirs. Can you explain that?
Well, you know, if they each own property 50-50, then the first one to die with no will, the property goes to the wife, and then the third each to the two children. And then when the wife, which would have been Graciela, passes away, everything goes to the two children. In both instances, it's subject to any administrative expenses, but just from a, sorry for the cliche, but a 1,000-foot view, the only people who were heirs of the estate, ultimately, were Freddie Alvarez and Maria Kingery, and they were going to get things 50-50.
Now, as part of this letter, I see on page 6, there's a section on the proposal for an interim distribution. Can you explain to the court the purpose of that proposal?
Well, in a way, it was kind of it's almost like a peace offering. It's kind of saying, well, it looks like we've got, from Federico's estate, we could distribute $28,000 to Freddie Alvarez, $28,000 to Maria Kingery, and $28,000 to Graciela Alvarez estate. We still have money in the Federico estate to cover claims and anything else that came up, including extra compensations. But the idea was, my idea at least at first was, let's see if we can take these two estates and move them down into just one estate, because everybody's going to be 50-50.
This proposal for an interim distribution was not an offer to apply anything to these other clients.
It was just, we think in this one estate we have some additional funds and we can make distributions to an equal distribution based on the one-third, one-third, one-third. We thought we could have, I guess it would have been $84,000.
Were, at that time, did anybody accept, or was there an interim distribution made?
There was no interim distribution made.
Do you remember why? Did any of the heirs, Maria or Freddie, object to that?
Well, I know that fairly early on, Maria King, Maria Kingery objected to any distribution. She said that the state court case was going on, and that she and her mother's estate had claims against her brother, and that until that state court case was decided, she would object to any distribution in either estate.
I'm going to show you what has been marked as plaintiff's exhibit 16.
Copies of front and back of every check that she talked about, and says here, as you know, all documents have been provided to Mr. Hamburg and are currently in his possession, which I did not think turned out to be true. It also refers to the fact that you had an engagement letter where you charged $350 an hour, which was inaccurate as well. And she wanted, I'm sorry, she asked for an itemized statement of retirement expenses from the outset.
Did we provide that to her at that time?
Did not.
Do you remember why?
Well, I responded, I have a response later on that we're going to identify.
Let me move on and I'll show you that. This is Plaintiff's Exhibit 17. Recognize that?
Yes, Plaintiff's Exhibit 17 is an email that I received from Mrs. Kingery on dated May 27, 2014 at 3:35 p.m. About 10 minutes after the one we just talked about.
Is this a true and accurate copy of the email that you received from Mrs. Kingery?
It is.
Move to amend Exhibit 17.
No objections.
No objections.
Amended.
Tell us, if you would, the substance of this letter.
Well, as it says, this isn't my final answer, but I haven't stated all the objections I have. I'm going to retain somebody to represent me in probate matters. And the deed with the live estate, which is the right estate, quit claim deed we were talking about earlier, is very much a part of the litigation, and no decision will be made. And there's an objection with supporting documentation to Freddie's claims, and that she wants to see a ruling from the probate court on that and all other matters pending. And she still wants her documents within 2 days.
Not have the originals of any of these documents. What are you referring to there?
basically said, he's got everything, he meaning you. And part of that was to say, look, all we have is copies, and we don't have, my client does not have everything. And I said, if you didn't keep your original bank records, then you need to please go get them from your attorneys, or we can make copies of what we have, but that would be at your expense. The second thing was, you want me to go on?
Yeah, go ahead and demand the time and expense records.
Okay, well, this was a theme throughout the case. She felt that you were an attorney and that you should be able to have your time and expense records. I felt that you are an attorney who is serving as an administrator, and the only way you get paid is by approval of the court. So what I told her was that you had not taken any fee or compensation or commission or extra compensation, and really at this point you hadn't decided what you were going to do about that. And so I kind of tracked through some of the expenses you had, the towing expenses, a courier charge of $175 each to Randy Galante, and you paid me $3,500. But you basically what I was saying is you will not get these records until the records that you want of his time and expenses until he petitions the court for fees.
And then post-interim distribution, I see you addressed that issue. This is just follow-up to the letter.
Yeah, it was all follow-up to the letter. But basically what I, you know, remember I had said we should make one-third distributions from Federico Alvarez's estate. And I was just reminding her here, you know, that was a distribution, proposed interim distribution from an estate against which you had not asserted any claims. And it would have been I didn't see there was any reason not to make that distribution. But, and the last thing I said is a recommendation on top page, please retain counsel to represent you in these matters.
At that time, did she get counsel?
No. I think the next counsel in this case was Mr. Daggs shortly before the declaratory judgment hearing.
So at this time, she was pro se.
Well, that was the only way I could communicate with him.
Let me show plaintiff's exhibit. Sorry, did I admit that one? Take a look at that exhibit. You recognize this exhibit?
Yes, this is an email I received from Mrs. Kingery. It's dated May 29th, 2014 at 2:46 p.m.
Is this a true and accurate copy of that email?
It is.
Move to admit exhibit 19.
Any objection?
No objection.
No objection, Judge.
All right, admitted.
If you could tell the court, what is the substance of this email?
Well, I guess from my perspective, we're sort of starting to see things fly out of hand. My general intention, my intention with the May 29th letter was to say, let's calm down, let's be reasonable, let me tell you what I think is going on. And at this point, she's saying, she basically comes back and says everything she said before. It's like nothing I said made a difference, but that she was, she seemed to feel like under the demand for time and expense records is that she's an heir and a beneficiary, and she's entitled to a regular statement of hourly fees and expenses in order to review it and see if she thinks it's necessary. again, she objected to the any distribution pending resolution of litigation. She objected to paying me any fees. And at this point, she's saying, middle of page two, it's clear to me that Mr. Hamburg is not only abusing his power as executive of his administrator, but is unable to be impartial, appears to have undertaken a personal vendetta to force me to spend money, and so on. He's incurring attorney's fees. And then she says at the end, I'm placing Mr. Hamburg on notice that I, as an heir and beneficiary of my parents' estates, will be filing a grievance with the State Bar of Georgia requesting the bar investigate his conduct, which I consider to be unethical and abusive. So, this has escalated pretty quickly. And this is the kind of thing you have to respond to.
This was on May 29th, 2014, and shortly after your previous correspondence we were discussing, right?
Yeah, it was about 3 hours after the first one, the one that I sent that earlier that morning.
We're going to address plaintiff's exhibit 20.
This is the email dated June 4th, 2014 that I wrote to Maria Kingery in response to Plaintiff's Exhibit 19.
Is this a true and accurate representation of the document you maintain in your file?
It is.
I would move to admit Exhibit 20.
No objection.
No objection.
Admitted.
This is a fairly lengthy email from you to Ms. Kingery. If you would explain the substance of this email to the court.
Well, first thing I'll say is this is a communication from me to Mrs. Kingery. I'm not copying Freddie Alvarez on this. This is sort of an effort to say, look, here's the way things are. As I see them, and let's be reasonable, but still stick up for you. The first paragraph is a complete denial of everything she's claimed. It says that you've acted impartially, denying that there's a vendetta, that he's abusing you or abusing his position. She had claimed that you were not making timely decisions, and I pointed out to her that you had agreed with counsel for both parties. There wasn't a lot of sense in making decisions about the expenses until there were expense claims, until there was money in the estate to pay them. And it says, I've said that she's complained about my May 27th letter, but it tentatively approved 75% of your claims, subject to your giving us the documentation.
Did she address, I think in the next paragraph, she addresses an objection to run these claims. Is she still pending an objection against these claims at this point?
Oh, yeah. Yes. And she referred to that before. But the basic thing I'm saying in the fourth paragraph is, look, if without supporting documentation, you're continuing to object to what Mr. Hamburg has said about your brother's claim, and your brother continues to object to his position on your claim, we don't have any supporting documentation, this matter has to be brought before the probate court for resolution, because as an administrator, the last thing you want to do ever is make a decision, hand out money, and have someone turn around and sue you for doing it wrong. Now, we talked about the documentation and how that went through, and pointed out on the top of the next page Walter Hamburg was selected jointly by the attorneys and by them after a mediation. He's met with you all, and he's not favoring anybody. I've said that you're not entitled to regular reports of his time and expenses. Walter Hamburg, are entitled to be compensated as provided by law, and that is with the court, with the order of the court. that other than the statutory commission, you're only entitled to such other compensations may be approved by the court based on a petition. No decision has been made about applying with this. But, you know, further on down, it says, look, he will apply, or he has to apply for fees, and when he does, you'll get all the time records and expenses and have an opportunity to have a hearing on that. I have also stated in here that I tried to put a strong paragraph in here about there's no basis for you to file or threaten to file a complaint or grievance with the state bar. He's doing his job as the administrator. He is a lawyer, but he's not your lawyer. He's appointed by the court. He's answerable to the court. And he's entitled to hire people to help him. And any compensation that's paid will be shown on the annual reports. And concludes in that paragraph, frankly, it is my experience that efforts by heirs to supervise or control an administrator frequently necessitate greater time and effort on the part of an administrator that otherwise would have been required to handle an estate. That having been said, Mr. Hamburg understands the stress inherent in family disputes and will always be open to any helpful communications or reasonable requests that you or your brother may have. And finally, I said, I know you have the right to go pro se, but this is a pretty complicated area of law, and I really think that you could benefit from having an attorney representing you. Part of what happens when I get involved in a case like this is to try to have a communication with an heir who is with a complaining heir or a disgruntled heir, just kind of clear the air and say, this is what happened, this is how this works, and try to be fair and accurate about it in hopes that everything will sort of will calm down. I also write these things with the idea that if you're fortunate, if I'm fortunate, the person who's receiving the letter or the email will take it to an attorney who knows what they're doing, then we'll look at it and give them some feedback.
And that is the substance of this.
That is the
looking at Exhibit 22, we will be skipping over 21.
Which we've already got. Letter dated June 13, 2014 to Mrs. Kingery regarding supplemental assignment claims. I'm sorry, could you hand me my little water bottle, please? Supplemental assignment of claims, and what it basically says is in communication related to your brother's claims against the estate, you're objecting to something alleging that there was a joint account and the account really belonged to Federico, not to Fred. And we've said in here, look, there's no case pending in any court that I know of. And based on the information that you have, Walter Hamburg is administrator, balancing the potential for recovery with the expense of litigation, he does not intend to pursue any claim against Freddie Alvarez arising from these joint account allegations. In fact, by that time, we had seen the joint account signature card, joint account right of survivorship. So we're basically saying, therefore, we're willing to assign these to you. Now, the The letter is copied to Michael Deaver, to Craig Jones, and to you. The copy to Craig Jones was to alert him to the fact, since he had a case pending already and was representing Mrs. Kingery in the state court of Fulton County against her brother, that this was a live issue, and he figured there was anything he could do about it in there, because you had no, you did not feel it was worth pursuing in the interest of the estate, but it was to alert him to that possibility.
Okay, and did you receive any response from Ms. Kingery about that?
Yeah, I believe I did. I mean, I'm not sure whether it's one of the things we identified or not, but one of the responses I got was, he's representing, Mr. Jones is representing me in the state court of Fulton County. You have no business contacting him. Don't contact him anymore. So something that was intended to be low-key helpful with copies to all the other attorneys was really rejected.
Okay, I don't know if I can do this. Is this an anchor copy of the letter that's in your files?
It is.
And I would move to release it. 22.
No objection.
All right, admit it.
Look at Pinkie's exhibit 23. Take a look at this document and tell me, do you recognize it?
I do. This was an email to me and to you from Maria Kingery dated June 22, 2014. Also copied Carmen Caldwell and Jeremy Neisser, who was drawn.
This is a copy of a document you made in the files?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, move to admit it.
Objection?
No objection.
No objection, sir.
Admitted?
If you could, explain to the public, why did you send this memorandum to Ms. Caldwell and Mr. Neisser?
I didn't send it to him. Mrs. Kingery sent it to him. Why she did that, I have no idea.
Okay.
Since they had withdrawn by then.
Okay. What is the subject matter of this?
This seems to track through anything that I have said with a header and basically say I disagree with it and I don't like it and so forth.
And this is in response to the communications that we've been going back and forth?
Yes.
Now, does she look over page two? There seems to be some references down the page about being reimbursed for by the administrator for explain that.
That was kind of interesting because at some point along, Mrs. Kingery had said, look, you had the opportunity to have these documents when you met with Mr. Neisser, and you should have looked at them. And it's not my fault that you didn't look at them. And if you want me to look for them, I request that I be reimbursed by the administrator for my time in making the copies, which will be substantial as each invoice is inside, so and so. She reminded you that you apparently had access to these. She claimed you had access to these things in Jeremy Meester's office. And I understand she wanted me to approve paying her for her time to go through and pull up the documents that would support the claims that we had supplementally approved potentially denied in my May 27th letter.
Now, over on the next page, I see something that was, I want you to bring it to the attention of the court. It's on page three, or low item three. The third paragraph, there's some references here to the $300 an hour rate that I was charged. Remember that?
Yes. Well, she refers to the fact that you would bill your time for work performed on behalf of the estates at a rate of $300 per hour to be charged to the estates, and that's involved in quotes. Mr. Meester forwarded such letter to me at that time for approval to retain Mr. Hamburg as administrator of the estate based on that hourly rate, which I approved. And to my knowledge, there's never been any different thing. What's happening here, in my opinion, is she's confused. She heard you, she saw the statement that you could charge a commission and viewed that as being on top of an hourly fee as opposed to being the basis, and if there's anything extra that's appropriate, you can charge. Because she says in the next paragraph that Mr. Hamburg's decided to charge a commission fee rather than an hourly fee, that he should let me know about that. And then she goes on to cite this is one of your many abuses of power, advice, conduct.
Over on the next page, is there anything else that's significant in this email that you think ought to be brought to the court's attention? In particular, in reference to what she had called to her as her debtor's claim. Do you remember that debtor's claim?
I do, yeah. I don't think the debtor's claim that you're talking about is the one that's here. I think later on in the case, Mrs. Kingery filed a petition for debtor's claim for expenses, claiming that effectively she was acting as the representative of the estate for several years and that she should be compensated for her time. That's what I see as the debtor's claim. I can tell you when that was filed, actually. But it's not this.
Yeah, that you're saying is that separate from the $16,000?
That's separate, apart from the $16,000. It's about $8,900. It was all settled in the declaratory judgment action. I think just based on the $16,600 number, what she's talking about here is her claim for a reimbursement of expenses.
Again, for the information court, how did you come up with this?
To come by this?
Yes.
Well,
this came through,
and I think this was attached to an email from Maria. It's clearly addressed to me, and I clearly got it.
But at this time, do you recall whether her and Caldwell and Jeremy Casey were still representing her?
I don't believe they were. Hang on just a second. I believe that they had withdrawn in early June, which is what they said was going to happen, and she had said, I'm taking on my own representation. I'm sorry, let me pick up on page 5. This was the part that I mentioned. In addition, I request once again that Craig Jones not be involved in this matter.
And to your knowledge, was Craig Jones still representing her in the state court action?
I thought so. I never had any communications with Mr. Jones other than to send him a copy of this letter, of that letter we talked about earlier.
It refers to claimants exhibit 24.
Basically, this letter for three pages goes through that and responds to pretty much everything that she said.
Looking down at the bullet points, of the first one, did there appear to be some confusion on her part as to whether I was her lawyer or...
You know, I wondered, because she had said at one point, I think she was absolutely convinced that she was right and Freddie was wrong. And she had, there's some reference in a prior correspondence that you were employed to be the representative of her mother's estate to go after her brother who had done all these bad things. Well, that's really not her job. Her job is to be the administrator and be fair, and you had already assigned those claims out to the court.
I'm calling it objective response to that question. He's trying to state the state of mind of my client, so he has speculated to know that. And that certainly, if he wants to quote from the document, it's fine. I believe that's what the exhibit is contains.
Do you have a response?
I think he's responding to a communication from her. I think he's entitled to infer what she was thinking and interpreting her writings. And he has to do that in order to respond.
No, he can give his opinion about what he thought this communication meant.
I think you mentioned that this is a bullet point of response to items in that memorandum. Is there anything else in this item that you submitted to the board?
No, I don't think so.
Any
questions? We're talking about 24.
That exhibit 24.
Well, for the first time, the second bullet point basically says gender doesn't have anything with this case, to do with this case. Mrs. Kingery had basically said in Plaintiff's 23, I guess it was on page 3, that as an heir and beneficiary of the state, parens, even if I'm not a lawyer and I'm just a woman, I'm entitled to an explanation to see where his time is spent. And I was trying to say that the fact that she was a woman and not a lawyer didn't have anything to do with this or any position that he took. Gender was not an issue in the case. The next bullet point tried to explain the compensation, denies various things. It was really just an effort to respond to everything that she raised.
Yeah, let me ask you this, though, at this point. This is a long list of bullet points responding to points. Was this a common practice as time went on in this case? We had to respond to various points of the meeting.
It was, but it was not in letters. It was in pleadings and filings that Mrs. Kingery made. This was one of the last attempts to kind of, from our part, to keep this off the record and out of the court. Like it says, you know, you're saying you said you don't have any money to hire a lawyer. Well, not long ago, we just offered to distribute $28,000 to each person. So, and it does conclude by saying, you should now be aware that Mr. Hamburg has filed petitions to resign as administrator of the estates of your mother and father, and we'll be following up with petitions.
And you referenced just now that this was an effort to head off the issues of problems. Following this, were there a lot of filings by Ms. Kingery that you had to respond to?
Well, there were, yeah. I had, you know, once the petition for resignation had been decided on and had been filed, I kind of thought we were done. Then when Mr. Freddie Alvarez objected to your resignation, attaching the handwritten thing from the state court, it was like the dynamite went off. I mean, there were multiple filings in both the states that we had to, respond to on your behalf. And it was all in pleadings in the record at that point.
And of all of these filings that you had to hearing on the declaratory judgment action, which of course addressed issues in part about these outstanding claims against the estate of both heirs. At that time, before that hearing, did you have any communications with Mr. Briggs about the supporting documentation for Maria's claims?
Absolutely. And they were provided. My suggestion was, show us the documents. We've been asking for them, and if we'll make a decision. So the documents were produced to us, I think, by Mrs. Kingery. And then, so we knew going into the hearing exactly what was going to happen with her claim, except that there was one thing we still had a question about, and Mr. Beggs brought that in on the morning of the hearing. You considered it, you approved it, and we approved roughly 90% of her claim.
So the communications with Mr. Beggs and the production by Mr. Beggs of these documents, was this just a few days before that hearing on the DAC action?
I think it was, yeah. There's a big time entry in reviewing all these records.
And so prior to the commencement of the hearing, was your testimony that there was generally an agreement with Mr. Beggs about what Ms. Kingery would be receiving?
I think that's true. I think that those agreements were stated before the court in the declaratory judgment. Now, I do not think Mrs. Kingery ever consented to your decision on Freddie Alvarez's claims, but she did withdraw her claim or the debtor's claim for additional expenses. So a lot of the declaratory judgment action when we finally got there was pretty well done before we got into court because we could see the documents that we needed.
Generate those from doing the work to producing these invoices.
Well, this is a system that I set up. I have timesheets that I keep on my desk, and I write in as I perform services. They're broken up into intervals, and I write in what I've done, what case it's on, my initials, and the time and tenths of an hour. At the end of the day, we turn them into a billing person, and who now comes in about once a week. She puts them into a computer program, and then we go from there. Those are our records.
And are these records maintained in the ordinary course of business?
Absolutely.
Do these records reflect the an accurate representation of the work that was done and the expenses that occurred in this case?
Yes, I do.
And what was your hourly rate?
Our hourly rate from the beginning of this case was $325 an hour.
And is this rate reasonable for having a new experience in this jurisdiction?
I certainly think so. I know a lot of downtown lawyers who are charging $550 an hour, and I think $325 is reasonable for me.
And were these expenses and fees that were incurred reasonable and necessary for the task that you were challenged to do?
Yeah, they were. You look at the totals and you think, my gosh, that's a lot. But this is over. Well, basically, I've been involved in the case for basically 3 years now. And as I tell people in my contracts, we can't always determine what it is we're going to have to do. The court may require us to do something. Opposing parties may require us to do something. So, yes, this is the time that I recorded, and I believe it was all reasonable and necessary.
And the summaries and the totals are all...
They are. I can kind of summarize them if you'd like, because I really had to work hard to figure out some of these things.
I think this it would be helpful if you could give the court an overview of the way that this panned out and how good it is.
Okay. If you turn over on 25A to page 16, that shows the top three-fourths of the page. It shows professional services rendered, 202 hours. That is, in fact, a total of all recorded time. It does not take into account no charge hours. It makes no distinction in terms of just listing the hours between, say, my time as an attorney and a legal assistant. So, I've gone through this, and I have gone through it page by page, item by item. There are, in this 202 hours, there are 9.4 hours that are just no charge altogether. And there's 18.3 hours of legal assistant time, which was billed at $65 an hour instead of my $325. So my time was billed at 174.3 hours. Preliminarily, it was billed at $325 an hour. I say preliminarily because if you look over on 25B, the first entry is a credit treated with billing adjustment of $2,440, which is a credit I gave on the first bill. In other words, I just reduced the amount that was being charged. And later down, I guess it's before the there's another place that says credit for $260, which was in November. There was some type of an adjustment credit I made, which was, it's part of the 202 hours, but it's not something that was billed for. So when you get down to the end of all that, I can summarize it this way. There was a total of time you'll see at the back on page 16 of Exhibit 25A, $57,837 each. The adjustment of $2,444 and the adjustment of $260 brought that down to $55,133. You had given me a retainer of $3,500. I spent $8 of that filing entries appearance in the probate court initially, and I applied the other $3,492 to the first bill that I sent, leaving $51,641. Then you paid me, you paid the first bill, the one that was in July, which was the only series of price I sent. I billed $6,304.35 with $20.35 in cost. You paid it in full, so I applied $6,284 to fees. That leaves $45,357 due as of July 7th. And there is $197.10 in cost that I have gone through and figured out that I was not reimbursed for a total of $45,554.19.
And that last number you gave is the amount that you're still due.
I was going from memory.
These do stick together. You mentioned that there were some expenses for paralegal, I think $60 an hour.
Legal assistant, yeah.
Was that done pursuant to your instructions and under your supervision?
Yeah, in fact, it was done by me. I just felt like it wasn't fair to charge full lawyer's time for some of those things. I'm coming out here to talk to
somebody. So you're the only person who can bill on this?
Yes, but I bill at lawyer rate, which is JWS, and LA, which is legal assistant, and that's a $65 rate.
I'd like to move to amend Exhibits 25A, B, and C.
Mr. Alvarez?
Thank you. No objection, Your
Honor. All right, admitted.
Is there anything else on these invoices that you want to bring to attention to the court?
No, I'm closed up. If you have other questions, I'll do my best to take it.
No, that's all right. That's all the questions I have.
I was just wanting to make sure the microphones were turned on. That's all. Thank you.
You're not.
Thank you.
Spears, how many cases have you dealt with in probate?
About?
Hundreds?
Hundreds of cases. Do you consider this case as being a complicated or simple case?
I will say that on its face, the issues are simple. You have to sell a house, you have to deal with a car, you have to deal with tangible personal property. When you get beneath the surface, it's not simple at all. There's been litigation going on between you and your sister that I have seen before I even got involved since, at least open in court since 2011.
And how many findings you have to deal with in this case?
A lot. Well, up there, lined up in the middle of the desk behind you, are six notebooks. There are three full of pleadings for your mother's estate and three full of pleadings for your father's estate.
So it would be fair to say 160?
Well, some of them, I would say certainly 120. Now, you know, that list, just so you understand, listed as a pleading is something, for instance, that is filed. I really wasn't listing leaves of absence and stuff. But if, for instance, there was a motion filed and then there was an order and I didn't have anything to do in between there, they're both listed. But they're not necessarily things that I had to deal with.
And did you have to, approximately how many findings that Ms. Kingery filed that you have to respond to?
Approximately. hard to say. I can say at least 18 or 19 in your mother's estate and probably 18 in your father's estate.
And when you were dealing with those findings, you also had to consult with your client.
Did it,
correct?
Yes.
And your client had to dedicate time in order to resolve or accomplish the response to that file.
Yes.
And those findings are in addition to the series of emails and correspondence you had to send to her that you previously testified to and which has been submitted into evidence.
My time covers all of them.
Okay. But the responses to the pleadings we're talking about is in addition to these responses to the emails.
Oh, yes.
And to the letters.
Yes.
And did those findings, first of all, let me show you Exhibit 15.
Yes.
Did that's the letter that you sent to both counsels, as you previously testified. And in that letter, were there any claims filed by Mrs. Kingery and
I think the claims that had been filed prior to that letter were you had filed a creditor's claim for reimbursement on your father's estate. Your sister had objected. She had filed a creditor claim for reimbursement on your mother's estate, and you had objected.
So there were claims and objections prior to you mailing the letter to the lawyers.
Oh, yeah.
And in that letter, did you propose a solution to resolve those objections and those claims?
Well, I stated the administrator's position on all the claims.
Yes, sir.
I asked for additional documentation. So rather than what I would say is I think we stated a path to resolution that we proposed, subject to production of documentation.
In other words, if I produce it, what you were asking, my claim would be resolved.
Not as long as your sister objected to it.
Subject to the objection.
And the same thing is true for hers. As long as you objected to hers, it wasn't going to be correct.
But the letter said if you produce this document, the administrator would be willing to satisfy the claim subject to Mrs. Kingery's objection and the other way around. That's right. Isn't that so?
Well, in each case, I basically said, if either of you have any objections, let me know. Well, I think it was an effort to get there, but we didn't get there.
But the state was prepared to satisfy the claims at the right time if there were no objections or if the objections were resolved.
Yes, that's correct.
And I'm going to show you what I have marked as Freddy 1. Do you recall seeing that document?
Yes.
And how did you see the document? That is the settlement from the state court, correct?
It is.
And
I think what happened with this was I had filed petitions to resign in both the states.
Yes.
In June. And my recollection is that sometime in August of 2014, August 25th, 2014, You filed an objection to his, to Mr. Hamburg's withdrawing and attached a copy of this Freddie 1, this consent settlement agreement. And you basically said, I don't think he should resign because we settled everything.
And did you and your client discuss the document?
We did, but I'm not going to reveal what we discussed.
Well, I'm just asking you to discuss the document. Were you under the impression that the case had been settled after reviewing the document between Mrs. Kingery and I?
I was under the impression that the state court case had been settled.
And the differences in this case, I bring your attention to paragraph 1.
The plaintiff and the defendant shall share equally the proceeds of the estate property contained within the estate of Federico Alvarez and Graciela Alvarez, less any expenses awarded by the administrator.
If that lets you believe that the case has been settled, the objections and the claims.
Well, one could certainly look at it that way. I have to say that in all fairness, I don't believe your sister looked at it that way.
Well, I'm not asking you how she looked at it. I'm asking you, what did you perceive upon receipt of that document? As you previously testified, that the letter said, no, we object for the administrator to be dismissed because the case has been settled.
Well, here's how I looked at it, Mr. Alvarez. I looked at it. The state court case, where everything had been assigned to you all, was over. There was nothing going on, so that whole position that we can't make any distributions until the estate case, until the state court case is over, was done. That was gone. But the only thing that remained in this estate was resolving these two creditor claims. And it said, less any expenses awarded by the administrator. I did not personally read that as saying, and we consent to him doing anything he wants to do. I felt that he still had to do his job, he still had to take a position on the claims, and he still had to ask for documentation.
I understand that the documentation had been previously requested in this letter, in this, with your letter, exhibit 50.
It had been.
And upon receipt of that document, being you perceive that that has been resolved?
No, I had not. I felt what this was, I felt this was saying, the only thing left we've got to deal with is these two claims for reimbursement of expenses that you had submitted and your sister had submitted and both of you had objected to.
Had those And was it a statutory basis for Mrs. Kingery to object to my claim for reimbursement of the funeral expenses?
I think if you paid the funeral expenses, the law is clear that you're entitled to it. Her claim was an underlying claim that said, and you paid it from an account that should have belonged to my father's estate. You've seen our position in there in all the letters before, that we thought that there was not evidence to overturn the presumption that was intended to be a joint account with survival and that it was your money. Your attorney had provided us copies of the account card that showed it to be a joint account with right of survivorship, and that's why we said that should be proved. Now, saying it should be proved and actually paying it in a case like this are very different. Because,
what do you mean by that?
Well, I mean, for instance, if your sister is complaining about everything that you did and many things that my client did, feels that he is colluding with you, siding with you, biased against her, towards you, I can't tell him in good conscience that he can pay that claim that he acknowledges without a court order, because the court order is his protection.
I understand that. But was my claim for reimbursement of funeral expenses satisfactory to you after I provided the document that you requested?
Yes.
Was it a payable claim?
I thought it was a payable claim.
And was that submitted to you shortly after you requested it in the letter in exhibit
15.
15?
Yes.
Like, the statement had been closed if we had agreed that there were no, that the claims we have withdrawn the objections to the claims present, correct, at the time?
Look, if there were any point in the administration of this estate where you two agreed, it would have been closed.
And that was in sometime around August 2014. About?
Well, August 2014 was when you objected to Mr. Hamburg's petition for resignation.
Yes, sir.
I would say that by the time that we held the hearing on the declaratory judgment was held in, gosh, I guess January 2015, we had the court order, we had seen sufficient documentation, and we proceeded to pay everything there was except Mr. Hamburg's fees and my fees.
So there was no need to go forward, continue these things, as far as he has known?
Well, I can't say that. I mean, your sister had said from the beginning that she was going to complain about Mr. Hamburg's fees, and she was going to complain about
yes.
my fees. So I thought that we would, I had hoped that we would be able to resolve these things, but we wound up back here for this.
Other than for what she said.
I will say that you responded, and if I read your document correctly in response to the court setting this for a hearing, you had stated that you understood, you had looked at and understood the claims that we had made for fees and for commissions, and that you were not objecting to them, but you were objecting to having to pay them all. You thought the payment should be skewed towards your sister's share of the estate.
Okay, well, that's what I have to mean. And also in some of your pleadings, you have asked for her to pay attorney fees, haven't you?
I don't recall that. I mean, it certainly could be, but I don't recall. I'm not saying it didn't happen. I was pretty upset when I found that a state bar grievance had been filed against my client, and something had been sent into the court saying that it happened. I might well try to say that should be stricken and maybe attorney's fees, but I didn't make a separate motion. It's possible, but we tried really to try to go right straight down the middle as much as we could and not take a side on this.
I understand that you want to be neutral, that you have done a lot of extra work that was not, didn't have to happen because her fight, don't you agree?
I think it speaks for itself.
Thank you.
All right. Any questions?
Just very briefly, Judge.
All right. Brevity is appreciated.
Captain Mr. Spears.
Sure.
A few questions for you. During your direct testimony, there were a lot of exhibits that were tendered. That were communications from you and Ms. Kingery.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, does that suggest that there were no communications with Mr. Alvarez?
Absolutely.
So of the communications that were had in this case between you and the heirs, 100% was to Ms. Kingery?
Are you saying from beginning to end?
I'm asking you if there are documents in your possession that are communications to Mr. Alvarez that you've chosen not to make exhibits today.
I first met Mr. Let me just respond to that as best I can. I first met Mr. Alvarez at the hearing on the declaratory judgment. At some point afterwards, he sent me an email saying, I intend to submit a claim against my sister for expenses or for having to do more work than I thought. I'd like you to be prepared to testify on that. I did not respond. I sent Mr. Alvarez a communication, a letter that said, not too long before this hearing, that said, your sister has claimed that you somehow purchased the house, the parents' house, through a straw man, and that you have colluded with whatever. And I'd like to know what your position on those is. And he wrote back and said no to both. That's it.
That's it. Now, you had to testify just a second ago that part of the issue still pending before the court are Mr. Alvarez's requests or prayers for relief that he get a disproportionate amount of the estate based on some wrongdoing or litigious conduct on the Skinner's part. Is that your understanding?
That is my understanding. That's still alive and well.
That is an issue that's going to be today. That's Mr. Alvarez's claim. That's not Skinner's claim.
I'm sorry, yes, that's not Mrs. Kingery's claim.
With regard to, part of the issues that were dealt with in the communications between you and Mrs. Kingery had to do with her requests for the amount of fees that the estate was incurring from the administrator.
Yes.
And I think you made your position clear that she really had no right to know, or she had no right to any information about it until the court approves it.
I think a little bit. I think what I tried to say is the administrator serves at the pleasure of it, under the supervision of the court. He cannot just take fees without asking the court for the fees. And that at such time as he petitioned the court for fees, and said, I believe there will be extra compensation requested in this case, then all the time records will be produced and you'll have an opportunity to review them and come to court and have a hearing on them if you want.
Now, let's take it out of the context of an administrator. If he were a private attorney and he were billing a client, would you think it would be unreasonable for a client to call and say, Mr. Hamburg, where are we on fees?
Not at all. But he's not a private attorney representing her.
I'm not trying to argue that point with you, sir. But I will direct your attention to plaintiff's exhibit number 2, which is the letter from Mr. Hamburg. I've had to mention this issue.
Oh, I got it right here. Thank you.
And it's clear in that letter that he intends to charge $300 per hour. It's also clear that he intends to petition the court at some point in time for approval of that. Is that a fair statement?
Well, I think he says any fees and expenses that I incur, however I record them, will be subject to the approval of the court.
Now, I don't think we're disagreeing. Okay. But it clearly says here he intends to charge $300 an hour. He can't get it until the court approves it. I think it's the point that you're trying to make. I'm not trying to put words in your mouth, sir.
I think the distinction I'm trying to make, Mr. Barrett, and I apologize, I'm not trying to argue with you, but I think how you keep your records and how you bill your records are related but different things. He's keeping his records, charging at $300 an hour, but none of that matters until it's presented to the court, and then only does it matter to the extent that the court approves it. But yes, everybody agreed he was going to keep his time at $300 an hour, and that was the basis of his billing.
But I guess where you and I must disagree is that she has no interest in knowing how the hours are accumulating that are initially going to be charged at $300.
I think that's absolutely right. She does not. In my opinion, because he's not her attorney one, and she does not have the right to supervise him. He is not her. He's not the errand boy. He's not the person who's there to take directions from her. And a lot of people don't understand that. And that's one thing you try to clear up early on in cases like this is, look, you don't get to tell the executor what to do. You don't get to say, or the administrator, you don't get to say, you write this letter. No, you can't write this letter. You have to ask my opinion to do everything. So no, he was not responding. He was not, I think it was perfectly legitimate that he said, you get to see the records before the court has any ruling on them, but no, I don't have to give you a monthly bill, a weekly bill, an hourly bill, anything. I don't have to tell you how much it cost for me to do this particular task.
It's your position that as an heir of the estate, she has no interest in that information about how much of the estate is being charged or is expected to be charged.
I think that she is interested, but I think that she has no right to that information until he actually petitions the court and says, here's what I wish to do with what I've recorded.
And do we agree that is a legal distinction in the probate code or in the fiduciary code? It doesn't apply to general practitioners working for a client.
Probably the two exceptions I see, one if it's a contingency case, I don't think it matters. And two, if it's, the other one just flitted away from me. But depending on what the fee agreement says, if it says I will bill you monthly, I will bill you at the end, then that's how it works. So I think, but yeah, in general, if you hire a lawyer to represent you on your case on an hourly basis, you're entitled to know what that lawyer's doing. Although you have to be reasonable. You can't be asking him three times a day.
We do agree on that. you had mentioned that the person has no right to try to direct the administrator. I didn't see it, and maybe I missed it, but in the communications between you and Mrs. Kingery, I didn't see where she was trying to direct any conduct of the administrator. Now, I'll acknowledge and agree that she expressed general dissatisfaction, but I don't think. Did I miss it? Is there something in there where she say, I think he needs to stop doing this or he needs to do this?
Well, I think one of the things throughout the thing is, why don't you just go ahead and approve my claims and disapprove Fred's? I think that was it. And I think in terms of asking for things when she wanted them, she wanted, basically my sense is, this is my opinion, but that she believed in this case that she was entitled to get what she wanted, when she wanted it, how she wanted it, and that it was his job to do that.
But you can't point to any specific instruction that she gave him to do or refrain from doing any of this.
I can say that she gave him demands to produce documents and so forth like that. But there's a thing, there's some stuff, I don't want to go back to the house, but there's some stuff back in the house about, you were supposed to, you didn't ask us to do this. And I think she felt that I think she felt as some people do, that the administrator works for us, and we get to tell him what to do. He's got to ask us, and I think it's pretty clear in the house that they were entitled to be consulted with, and in fact, they were signatories on the house sale contract, but it's pretty clear that they were to be consulted on some things, but not that they weren't driving the car.
Understood. All right, that's all the questions I have for you.
Thank you.
I have a very brief question. Just a couple of questions on this. One question.
Okay.
On what we were causing with, you remember right before the causing on the house, she sent the email we talked about earlier that she said unless the claims were paid, she would not go to the closing.
I did. And I was not involved at that point, but I remember seeing that.
Okay, you saw the communication, but that would, in your opinion, would that be something that would be where she was demanding and directing the administrator to do something?
Well, I think it was something where she did something that required you to respond to it.
Mrs. Mayor, a couple of questions.
Just a couple.
Just since 2014, I've noticed in the billing, the most of the billing
has been related to responses in dealing with Mrs. Kingery. Isn't that so? I would say more than 80%.
I have no idea the percentage. It's a lot. I mean, after we petitioned the court to resign and you objected, the pleadings and the filings just exploded in this case.
From Mrs. Kingery?
Yeah, mostly from Mrs. Kingery. I cannot put a proportion on it.
Thank you. You can step down.
Thank
you. Next. I'll give you a second, Mr. Spears, if you need.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'm going to take just a moment to regroup, and I'm going to call Ian Ferreira.
All right.
Could you ask Mrs. Ferreira? She's outside.
Ann Ferreira, attorney. You need more?
I would say it's very reasonable. In fact, I think it's a little lower than what I see very often.
You should tell me that. I'm going to ask you to testify on my behalf in this case, and I'd like to ask you what you have done to prepare for this testimony.
What I did was first, you and I had a conversation. I came to your office. You had a number of volumes with pleadings. I believe there were three for each one of the estates. It was a husband and wife estate. And I went through those on my own. And I made a list of all the pleadings and all the different file folders that I would like to have copies of to take back to my office and review on my own. someone from your office or you made those copies at my request, brought them to my office, and then I've spent a fair amount of time going through all the Fulton County dockets, your own docket of your pleadings, correspondence, copies of emails. I've gone through Mr. Hamburg's billings, I've gone through your billings, and I've spent a number of hours.
Okay, you said that you had reviewed the dockets for the Fulton County, for this case?
Yes.
Just for the record, I'd like to admit, Lansington 28, which is a copy of the docket with this court for the state of Federico Alvarez, and 29, which is the docket for the state of Graciela Alvarez.
No objection.
Can you do this, Mr. Mayor? It's our court docket on both of the states.
Yes, these are the court dockets for both cases, because Mr. Herrera referred to the state.
Admitted?
Yes. Did not give you all copies in just a second.
What are the numbers again?
28 is the Federico Alvarez estate, and 29 is the Graciela Alvarez estate.
Yes, I do.
And you keep those in your custody? Do you treat them just like if you were representing a client in the case?
Yes, I do.
And do you use those records as the basis for petitioning for extra compensation if you decide to do that?
Yes, I do. To get the court to determine issues like competing claims. Generally, they're in the form of a petition for final settlement of accounts. At the time that I've marshaled everything into the estate, we've paid all the debts that are not disputed, and there are reimbursement and claims brought by parties that have to, that continue to be disputed.
And is it fair to say that your protection as an administrator is the court order? Unless it's what you ask the court to do?
Always, yes.
You've had a chance to review my time records in this case.
Yes, I have.
I want to ask you a couple of, bar rule 1.5 questions with respect to fees. Are these really going to the question, were these fees reasonable and necessary? So I can start with that. Do you feel that $325 an hour is a reasonable fee to the housing board?
Yes, it is.
In this case.
Yes, it is.
Do you have an opinion as to whether the work that was done in this case was necessary?
I believe it was, yes.
Okay. One of the questions about fees, as administrator, you hire attorneys to represent you.
Yes, I do.
Mm-hmm. And as a private attorney, you also handle private cases on your own.
Yes, I do.
So you're familiar with attorney billing records?
Yes.
I'm going to ask you this. Do you think $325 is a fee, an hour that is or is not customarily charged in this area for similar work?
It is well within the range. And as I believe I testified, it's probably mid-range. there are many attorneys out there who do fiduciary law who are very experienced, who charge substantially more per hour.
What do you think is the amount of time and labor involved and the skill necessary to deal with a case like one? I'm asking specifically about the Alvarez.
Well, I looked at, one of the reasons I wanted to look at the dockets as well as Mr. Hamburg's own billing records was I wanted to make a determination as to reasonableness when you got in the case. At what point were you retained by Mr. Hamburg to help him, assist him with legal aspects of this case? And I thought it was very interesting and to find out that Mr. Hamburg had put in almost half of his hours by the time he got to the point, it appears, to almost want to resign because things had gotten so difficult and they were moving on to a new legal level of opposition and filings and caveats and objections. So it seemed very appropriate for Mr. Hamburg to retain you at the time he did. But so much of the administrative work, so much of the groundwork that you do any time you take on an estate had been done. But it appeared from the pleadings and emails and so on that I saw, once you got involved, it was for a specific series of things that looked like they were going to be happening going forward. This estate wasn't moving in the direction that it needed to move in order to be finalized, pay final claims, make distributions, shut it down. So that, to me, supports to a very large extent the reasonableness of, number one, you being retained to help Mr. Hamburg, and also the reasonableness of what you needed to do going forward in terms of aggressive pleadings, but also responding to all the different pleadings that were coming in, all the responses. And I made a list and categorized all these pleadings and responses, and it appears that all the action were very reasonable at that time.
You said you looked at my billing records and at Mr. Hamburg's. Did you find instances where we both did something on the same day that we did not, or we didn't both charge for?
No, I didn't find that there was overlap in billing, and I did specifically look for that. There were a lot of issues, as I said, that Mr. Hamburg had already resolved that you were not involved in at all. I think specifically, so much of Mr. Hamburg's initial time on this case was surrounding the house and getting that house because it was the primary asset, so I understand from all the pleadings. And that sale had gone through, I believe, by the time you were retained. So you were dealing with some very new and different issues that were coming up. So I didn't see that overlap, which I've seen before, where there's an overlap of duplicity of efforts, but I did not see that in any of the buildings.
And you're aware, just for the record, that Mr. Hamburg filed his own petition for a final settlement and his own petition for extra comp, and I did not represent him in those matters.
Correct.
Okay, one of the issues here in the rule is the likelihood that the acceptance of particular employment will preclude other employment by the lawyer. You see that here in this case?
I think that I don't really understand that rule. Is when you take one case, obviously that takes away your time and energy to do other cases. So in that respect, every time we take on another case, it eliminates the time we could work on something else.
Have you ever been wrong about how much time you thought a case would take?
Every day.
One of the other factors is the amount involved in the results obtained. Now, the amount involved in this case was $360,000. How do you feel about the results that were obtained in the with respect to the amount that was involved here?
Well, at first glance, I think anyone would say if you have an estate, in my experience, with $360,000 or $350,000, if someone were to pay professional fees for administrator and fees for an attorney that were a big chunk of that estate, that should take one should take a second look at that. And of course you do, because people say, oh, that's a lot of money. And it is a lot of money. On the other hand, when you look at all the work that was done, when you look at all the notebooks, you look at the fact that this was two estates, yes, they have overlapping, they're very similar estates, but you're still looking at an administrator having potential liability for two estates. So the legal work, the administrative work is benefiting two estates, but it's really one hourly rate that you are charging for both estates. I mean, we're dividing this, I believe your petition asks for it to be 50-50. So you really, I think that because of the litigiousness of this entire two estates and having to respond and it being expanded, and every step of the way it seemed to get response after response after objection, it's unfortunate, but I think that the results that were obtained, which is that it's now ready to be closed, I think all the work was probably was necessary in order to get there.
So do you think that, in your opinion, based on your review of the records and the documents, are the fees that I've charged, proposed to charge here, reasonable and necessary in this case?
Yes.
Thank you. Any more questions?
Thank you. Do you have any questions?
No questions.
All right. Do you have any questions? You can step down. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to excuse her if you...
Yes, Your Honor. That she
all right. Excuse. You're free to go. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Not yet. It's coming.
Executive Committee of the Fiduciary Law Section for the State Bar of Georgia.
You serve in any capacity in the Jack County on the Ethics Commission?
Yes, I'm currently a member of the Ethics Commission for DeKalb County.
What is your primary area of practice?
Fiduciary laws, particularly probate and trust litigation.
Do you have experience in estate administration matters?
I do.
Could you tell the court an overview of your experience in the area?
Yeah, generally I handle estate litigation, litigated matters, but almost all of those involve some sort or some aspect of the administration of an estate or a trust. I also do some representation of fiduciaries simply on the administration of the estate or trust.
And you have experience in evaluating standard performance of the administrators or trust heads of the estate?
I do.
And how long have you been doing that, working that particular area?
15 years.
Are you familiar with the duties of a personal representative of an administrator of the estate?
I am.
Could you tell the court your understanding what the duties are?
Sure. Generally, the duties are to administer the estate of an estate and to garner all the assets, to pay any debts, and to ultimately distribute those assets to the beneficiaries. During all of this process, your duty is to preserve those assets for the beneficiaries as well.
Does the administrator have to balance interest in the assets of the estate with claims by creditors?
Yes.
And does the administrator have to make decisions about estate claims?
Yes, if there are claims.
And if there is anything at the end, is it the administrator's duty to distribute that estate?
That's correct.
Are you familiar with the provisions of the probate code regarding statutory compensation?
Yes, I am.
Are you also familiar with the code regarding extra compensation?
I am.
Do you have experience in dealing with assessing these kinds of compensation for a fiduciary?
I do. Oftentimes in the litigation that I'm involved in, that can become an issue to litigate and for the court to make a determination on.
Is there any particular methodology that you would use in analyzing compensation for an administrator, the performance of the administrator, other than the probate code, case law?
Not necessarily. I mean, it's on a case-by-case basis, and under the statutes, the court has a lot of discretion, you know, looking at the complexity of the estate and things like that.
Your Honor, I'd like to offer Mr. Deutsch as an expert in the state administration and fiduciary compensation.
Any objections?
No objections.
No objections.
All right. Let's go on as an expert.
Mr. Deutsch, who are you paying to testify here today?
You did.
Are you being paid for your work in this case?
I am.
Tell the court, what is your compensation?
My hourly rate, which is $325 an hour.
What was the purpose of my attention in this case?
To ultimately testify as an expert witness, but more particularly to look at the issue of the compensation being paid or proposed to be paid to you as administrator of these estates.
Okay. And did you do an investigation of the files in this case in order to
I did. I reviewed the files. You sent me a number of documents electronically, which I reviewed. I also reviewed the original file in your office.
Yeah. Did you review the letters of administration?
I did.
Did you review the pleadings in both probate files?
I did.
Did you review the pleadings in the state court file?
Yes, I did.
Were there annual reports to the heirs that you reviewed?
I did. It appeared that you had sent annual reports to all the heirs. I reviewed those.
Okay. Were you familiar with documents involving assignment claims?
Yes.
And did you review those?
I did.
You recall the nature of the state court action?
Yes. Essentially, it looked like it started out as a dispute between the two beneficiaries of this estate regarding some claims regarding their parents' assets. There was a battery allegation as well included in the original complaint.
Was this a mixture of claims that were peculiar to the estate and also individual claims?
That's what it appeared to be to me, yes.
Did you review correspondence files?
I did.
Did you look at email files?
single email because they were voluminous, but I did review them.
Did you review invoices in this case?
I did.
I'm going to refer you to, I believe, the exhibits. One.
Okay.
On both estates.
Okay, that would have been hourly rates?
Correct.
Okay. And I think the discovery sheets with summaries on.
That's correct, the first page of summaries.
Now, did you read through all of these entries in these invoices?
I did.
And did you read through all of these invoice entries in relationship to the review of the entire file?
Yes.
Okay. In reviewing all of the file materials that you looked at, were you able to come to a conclusion about the requisite skill of the administrator in the performance of his duties?
Yes, it appeared that based on the complexity of the estate that the administrator had the requisite skill, you as having a lot of experience in these types of cases and our attorney to deal with the litigiousness of these two estates.
And having reviewed the documentation, you probably were able to come to an opinion and in reasonable degree of professional certainty whether the administrator, based on these facts that you have reviewed and accepted them, acted with acceptable standards for performance of his duties?
Yes.
What was the basis for that?
Again, the review of all the documents that we have already spoken about, as well as a detailed review of these invoices.
Would you note the hourly rate that was listed on these documents?
Yes, it's $300 an hour.
In your experience, is $800 an hour a reasonable rate for an administrator to charge when they are dealing with areas of extra compensation?
Yes.
And did you see also in the file the letter, or in the files the letter that I wrote to the heirs regarding the amount of the compensation?
I do. I believe that was back in 2013.
Yes. Did you see anything in that letter that you thought was unreasonable or out of order?
No.
Having reviewed the documentation file, were you able to come to an opinion within a reasonable degree of professional certainty that the administrator's extra compensation is set forth in Exhibits 1A and 1B, as adjusted by the statutory compensation, were reasonable under the circumstances of this case?
Yes, I do think that the fees requested are reasonable.
And what is the basis of that?
Again, what we've testified about already, the review of the file, the review of the invoices, we did testify about getting some more background on the case from you as well.
Did the estate administration review the file involve a usually greater time record than might be expected of an estate at this time?
Yes.
Did the personal representative have responsibilities with respect to assets that were not subject to the jurisdiction of the probate?
Yes.
Can you put that at the same point?
It appears as so, yes.
Did you review the tax returns of the estate?
I did.
Were you familiar with the tax issues that were raised by the accountant because of the sale of the house on a stepped-up basis because of the quitclaim deed?
Yes, I could note those from the returns.
Okay. And would that have been a significant tax issue that needed to be addressed?
Yes, it could have been.
Did the personal representative also perform legal services? Did I perform legal services?
Yes, it looked like you performed all of the legal services until the time you hired Mr. Spears.
That's all I have.
All right.
No questions, you want?
No questions.
Very good.
All right.
Mr. Deutsch, you familiar with the Exhibit 2?
Those may be out of order.
You should have yours. Okay.
That document's already submitted to evidence.
spoke about earlier.
Okay, and it's based on an hourly rate of $300 per hour for services and you know, different rates for administrative and paralegal work.
Correct.
Now, it, this is
a I should say it says different rates for paralegal work.
Yeah. Based on representations in that letter, would it be reasonable or unreasonable for an heir or a beneficiary to inquire from time to time about the status of the fees accumulated by the administrator?
I think it's reasonable for an heir to inquire.
Okay. That's all the question.
All right. Anything on redirect?
Just a clarification. Mr. Boyce, the rate that you are being paid for your services today, was that a rate that I agreed to pay myself?
That's correct.
So I'm not adding the state.
Correct.
All right. You can step down, Mr. Deutsch.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Shall I release Mr. Deutsch? You're at the end of the day.
Yes, please.
Yes,
yes.
All right. You're free to go.
Thank you, Judge.
Thank you.
I think we're resting, Your Honor.
All right.
Would it be possible for me to answer the extra call for you?
So let's take a comfort break for a minute. How about that?
Appreciate that, Judge.
5 minutes?
5 minutes, thank you.
All right. Good morning, Paul. Tomorrow we'll work it out for your Decatur County situation. Let's do Monday at 1. We'll go to close the business or until we're done.
Thank you.
You have the same group, more or less?
I don't have parties.
Okay, I have pictures.
I have.
So look at this one, please.
You provided the copies.
That's right, you were getting copies.
Yes, so I'm listening two from
Freddie, which I have.
Correct, two of those, because I think.
Well, I can give him, I can give the court reporter all mine then, because the staff attorney has the same group.
Except for Freddie.
Except for Freddie, which I would keep. I definitely have to have a set, because we use those. We're working lawyers. So, you obviously can give, I can give them this group, and they should still be in order.
He was just asking whether we, he doesn't think how it's set at all.
Okay, well, John, we'll.
He was holding on to him for probably.
This whole period.
Yeah, we'll hold on to that.
But I'll keep my group.
Oh, he wouldn't want that.
Well, yeah, Jeremiah.
Just wasn't.
So what if we decide on this group of exhibits? I need mine back. I need to work on mine. I use them to work on yours.
What
reporter works on transcripts, but I work on yours.
He can have mine.
Go ahead.
Okay. Because mine were just given to me as a courtesy. So, Judge needs her. Do you have, is that okay with you, Mr. Spears?
I thought there were a couple that weren't. There was only one copy. So, did Mr. Alvarez do?
There are a couple.
He only has two.
Yeah,
three. Yes, three.
That's fine. So the court's got the number.
One of which is a duplicate.
$16,626.06. I filed an objection to the claim shortly thereafter. On June 21st, 2013, I filed a claim for the funeral of my father in the sum of $16,626.06. Mrs. Kingery filed an objection in July. Thereafter, a letter from Mr. Spears, which is Plaintiff's Exhibit 15 of Friday 2, either one of them is the same exhibit, was sent. And in that letter, Mr. Spears states that to resolve those claims, he needs certain documentation. I produced the documentation which is required justifying that the bank account that I had with my father was a joint account. Therefore, the funds would survive. I would take the funds by being the surviving account holder. And Ms. Kingery did not. She continued refusing to produce the documentation, and it was arguments between written arguments or emails back and forward between Mr. Spears and Ms. Kingery, and she went ahead and filed several pleadings of the court may know, challenging the request that have been made by Mrs. Spears in the letter. Then we went to state court on August 18, 2014, in a state court case that we had. And on that day, we entered into a settlement agreement, which is F1. In that settlement agreement, Your Honor, in paragraph of the settlement agreement, which states, the plaintiff and the defendant shall share equally the proceeds of the estate property contained within the estate of Federico Alvarez and Graciela Alvarez, less any expenses awarded by the administrator. The state court does not have the states, does not deal with the states. In that paragraph, it was unambiguous, it was clear, it was not pertinent to the state court at all. That paragraph basically says the claims and the objections that the parties have in the state court are resolved, are accepted. And it's up to the administrator. So whatever the administrator had proposed before in that letter, which is a proposal by the administrator indicating how the claims should be resolved by the production of the documents, I left to the administrator. Whatever the administrator said in the letter is considered to be is resolved by that paragraph. Relying on that letter, it grants the administrator the total discretion subject to the court order, to the probate court and under his fiduciary duties to proceed. It gives the green light to the administrator so that he can prepare the final taxation, tax returns, file the returns, the publications, and close the estates. That should have been it. Nothing else should have gone forward. The case was resolved, Your Honor. It was settled. Even though there was such a settlement, she disregarded the settlement and continued going forward, filing pleadings, challenging the claim that I had that supposedly had been resolved, and the administrator had agreed that upon production of the bank statements, it should be a payable claim, in which I had done it. And it went on and on and on through the, even until the last hearing, without a legal basis. It had not a legal basis to go on. The estate should have been resolved during said year. In the year 2014, during August 2014, it could have been the conclusion. But she went ahead and continued, and the administrator, as well as the attorney for the administrator, with much justification, they had to keep billing the state. And I submit to the court that that is something that the state should not be responsible for. That the case has been settled, and we agreed that the administrator and obviously the attorney could go ahead and could go ahead from that point forward and close it. More than 65 filings occurred since there since that day. As Mr. Spears had testified before, it was an explosion. She went out of control, and the estate and the administrator and the attorney kept billing the estate, and it is my contention that she should be responsible for all the attorney fees from that point forward, as well as the administrative fees. I have reviewed the statements from both Mr. Spears and Mr. Hamburg, and I have noticed that from that point forward, in excess of 80% of the activity in the accounts, the charges, you are not have been answering and responding to Mrs. Kingery's filings and emails and discussions pertaining to Mrs. Kingery. I have filed with the court a document which I had named Heir Freddie M. Alvarez Response to Administrator's Petition for Settlement of Account Approval of Final Distribution Plan on April 1st, 2016. In said document, I have petitioned or asked the court to assess attorney fees not only for that, but also for her failure to appear and pretty much boycott the closing of the house, blackmailing the administrator if she would not receive a satisfaction to the claim that she had filed when the administrator had no funds in his possession to pay her. And he dedicated a substantial amount of time there as well before Mr. Spears was employed. And Your Honor, I have cited OCGA 9-11-68 and OCGA 13-6-11. And those statutes provide for bad faith and stubborn litigation, just litigation in bad faith. And it is my contention that the state should not be responsible, but she should be responsible for those things. And Your Honor, and to conclude, it's not only I have personal knowledge that she has reported, filed a report in order to get her way with what she wanted to get, a report for the State Bar of Georgia against Mr. Hamburg. Also, I know that she has filed with the Judicial Commission a complaint against Your Honor, and she tried to get me arrested and file a report with the State Bar against me. She has been represented by 8 attorneys since this dispute commenced, and so it's not an excuse that she did not know what she was doing. She, whether the attorneys stayed with her or not, is something that is between her and the attorneys, but I'm confident that she has acted knowingly, intentionally, and she has well executed her actions and her fight before this court.
Thank you. Do you wish to cross-examine Mr. Alvarez, either of you?
I have some great questions, sir.
Okay.
Good afternoon, Mr. Alvarez.
Good afternoon.
The
you and I just met today.
Yes, sir.
Your daughter representing your sister in this case, Ms. Kennesaw. You, as part of your testimony to the judge just a few minutes ago, you made the assertion that more than 80% of the fees for the administrator and the counsel to the administrator were attributable to Ms. Kingery. Did you ever make that statement?
I made that statement, and that has been since August 14, 2018, when the settlement was reached.
I understand. Now, have you presented a document, entered into evidence, showing the math of how you came to 80%, or is that a speculation that you're making?
That is based on my review of the statement filed by Mr. Hamburg and the statement filed by Mr. Spears. They are exhibits submitted to the court.
There's no exhibit that matches your 80% assertion, though. That's the point I want to bring to the court. Is that true?
That is true.
All right. The part of the reason that we're here today is that you have asked the court to cast the cost of the attorney's fees, or part of the attorney's fees, against your sister. Isn't that true?
That is correct.
Okay.
It has been, based on what I have seen in my experience as an attorney for 36 years, is a obvious case of abusive litigation.
Now, it's a true statement that if I had to point to the two people in this room who are responsible for the litigation today, one finger's pointed at you, one finger's pointed at her. It's both of you, isn't it?
For the litigation today, no.
Are you withdrawing your claim against her for a disproportionate share of the estate?
I have no claim against her for disproportionate of the claim against the state. My claim is the prayers on one of my pleadings.
So you still maintain that claim? Is that your testimony?
It's in the prayer.
Okay, I don't want to argue with you about it. Now, you also made the assertion during your statement to the judge that Ms. Kingery boycotted the real estate closing. It's your word, isn't it? Boycott.
It's my word, but it has been testimony from both Mr. Spears and Mr. Hamburg that she sent emails directly into her attorney that she was not paid in advance the claims that she had against the state, she would not attend the closing.
There are two facts that are true about the closing. She was present, and she was not paid anything from the closing proceeds. Those are two facts. Is that correct?
Those are two correct facts, but before she attended the closing, Mr. Hamburg had to send letters to her and to her attorney, and those are the exhibits that the court has now, indicating that if she didn't go up here, the estate was going to be sued by the potential buyer based on breach of contract, and also it would be other damages, not only to the state, but to herself and to myself again, as well.
Mr. Alvarez, do you know who the purchaser of the real estate is?
I do not know who the person of the real estate is. I know only what I have seen in the documents that the administrator has provided me.
Is it a true and factual statement that you have no relationship with the buyer or anyone who has an interest in that property or a right to purchase that property?
That is true and correct.
That's all questions I have for you.
Thank you. Mr. Spears?
Wonderful question. So I'm happy to. Is there any truth to the allegation that you and Walt Hamburg somehow colluded with you to harm your sister in this estate?
Absolutely not.
Second question and last is, I have heard that you have objected to our petitions for fees or for compensation. Is that correct? You're not objecting to them?
I am not objecting. I think you have done an outstanding job based on what you had to work with.
Thank you. No further questions, Your Honor.
Step down, sir.
You really have been close to the edge.
Do we have anything else to talk about other than reconvening on Monday, 1 o'clock?
Your
the
Honor,
film crew in the back.
Yes, Your Honor. Will my permission slip be recognized on Monday as well to return?
I'm not so sure it will be.
Do
it
I need
probably has one date on it. Are you saying you want to come back?
I would like to see the conclusion. Yes, ma'am.
Really? Okay.
So I will file a subsequent one tomorrow. For your signature.
I don't think you need to file anything else. I will extend it. I will find a way to modify or to indicate that we're going to go another day.
Thank you.
And if you have permission to come in, we're starting at 1 o'clock.
I'll be here. Thank you.
I think they let you in even without the order, by the way.
Your Honor,
I had the order in hand.
Oh, okay.
Your Honor, can we do it at 2 o'clock instead of 1? On Monday.
That's not giving us a lot of time downtown.
We got only one side.
So 3 hours. If I let you guys go by the evening time. Otherwise, you hang around past 6 or 7. Mr. Barrett is really, you know, he's got to put his case on.
I expect to call my client, and I expect direct examination will probably go 45 minutes-ish. I'm sure there'll be cross-examination. Then I have one witness, and I expect it to be very brief.
So we might go wrap it up now. Would y'all agree to coming in 2 on Monday?
Yes, Sean.
Thank you.
Okay. We can do 2 o'clock.
Thank you so much.
Okay. Let's do 2 o'clock.
We'll follow your directions.
Okay. We'll go till we're done.
Shouldn't be long, though.
Okay. All right. Is there anything I'm missing, Ms. Kaplan?
No, ma'am.
All right. I have my exhibits back that I need. I'll have them with me for a minute. Ready? Oh, let me discuss one point with the exhibits. I don't have a 3 for Freddie. I have 1 and 2.
I think 1 was a duplicate.
1 is the consent order, August 18, 2014. That's the F1. The F2 is the duplicate. That's P15, which is the May 27, 2014 Spears letter. But at F3, I don't think you tendered.
I saw here, Judge, it was an attachment to.
Oh.
And yeah, there were the timesheets of John Spears.
It's handwritten. It's handwritten 3 pages.
He had written
F1.
I made a note for F3, but you don't have any documents to go with.
I think that's already in. F1, Judge, was the consent settlement agreement.
That's correct.
F2 was the exhibit E.
That was P15.
Or in judgment.
Wait a minute. That is the Spears letter.
The
May 27, 2014 Spears letter is P15, that's F2.
Yes.
I have that.
F3 were the timesheets of John Spears. And there was an objection and you sustained it.
There are no objections to John's timesheets.
I think the objection, by the way, Your Honor, I recall the objection was he was asking a question about Mr. Hamburg's timesheet and he presented the witness with my timesheet.
Oh, yes. Yes.
There you go. And so it didn't happen.
So I don't have any documents other than what's already in the file. And the timesheets are P1, 1A, and 1B. But those are him.
Right.
So those are Spears.
What he meant to show was claims 1A and 1B, which were Walt's time records. just didn't happen.
Okay, yeah, it did happen. That's right. But they're already in evidence.
They're already in evidence.
They're already in evidence, Judge.
Yes. But there are no F3s.
It's not F3, it's only F2.
Right. Okay.
Okay, Monday at 2.
Monday at 2. Thank you all. Appreciate your time. I think I have one with a yellow.
Kennesaw.
I didn't see all the trash.